Linda, I understand you want more information on the senator before you interview him next week. I pulled this dossier from the files at the Banner. I hope it's of some use to you.
Thanks, I'm sure it will be.
I watched your interview yesterday with Donald Lamar and Herb Callison. It was excellent. Only one thing, Linda, you seemed very nervous before the show. How come?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I guess I felt I wasn't prepared. Tom, that's not true. Donald Lamar showed up, and I didn't expect him to, and when he did, I had a flashback of the electroshock therapy room with Dr.
Perfectly Keller. Understandable. You went through quite a trauma. And after all, Donald saved your life.
No. Donald was the one who had Dr. Kellogg kill Alex Crown.
Fancy wrapping paper you got there, Miss Jenny.
Good morning, buddy.
Miss Jenny, I know you're mad at Clinton and I, and I don't blame you none. But I wish you'd just try to understand why Clint tricked you like he did. He didn't mean to hurt you none.
Once again, I suppose he has involved you in his machinations and sent you to do his bidding.
No, I came on my own. I just don't want you to be mad at Clint. Clint felt obliged to trick you. That's the only way he knew to keep you in town.
Buddy, I really do not wish to discuss this with you. Mr. Buchanan has tried my patience once too often. He has trifled with my... That's not concern you at all. I shall be very glad if I never see him again. God bless you.
Thank you. What's trifled mean? Trifled with what?
You're too young to understand that.
Well, I'd be much obliged if you'd tell me what it means.
Buddy, my advice to you is to study your school lessons with diligence and stay away from the likes of Mr. Buchanan.
But you even hardly know him.
How can I possibly know him, Buddy? He has misrepresented himself to me from the very beginning. Even after I discovered that he was married, he continued to try to ingratiate himself with me. He even went so far as to use a former relationship with Mr. Randolph Lord to keep me in this town and promote a present relationship with me. It is wrong. I will have no part of it.
You've got Clint all wrong. He's doing everything just to make you happy.
I will make my own happiness, Buddy. And when I do, it will not be with a married man.
Well, if it's him being married that's got you so upset, don't be. He's lost his wife and his family. He's all alone in this world. Alone.
Tina?
Hi, Vicky. How are the boys?
They're a little bit better today. It's very difficult for them being in this house without Clint.
I'm sorry. I mean, having lost Max, I know exactly how they feel. I understand all the pain and the heartbreak.
Have you spoken to Max since he walked out on you at the church yesterday?
Yes. I went to his suite at the Holden Towers, and I refused to leave until he told me exactly why he stopped the wedding. He said he did it because he doesn't believe that I love him. He thinks that I love Court.
Donald Lamar is a special prosecutor.
Yes, and Alex Crown was a big honcho for the mob. What if Donald ordered him killed because he had something on Donald? I mean, Donald obviously had something on Dr. Kellogg. That's why he followed his orders. Look, I know this all sounds very incredulous, but it's the truth. I swear it.
You mentioned this to anyone else?
No, I just remembered it yesterday. I was drugged by Dr. Kellogg, and he was just about to kill me when Donald Lamar burst in, and they had a big argument, and Donald kept screaming, leave her alone.
Well, of course, he was trying to save your life.
Yeah, but you see, Dr. Kellogg was frantic because I had discovered Alex Crown's grave. And he kept saying it's my life or his. So then Donald said, don't you have enough blood in your hands? Then Dr. Kellogg said, whose fault is that? I didn't want to kill Alex. You made me do it. And then he said that if Donald was going to pull him down and blame the whole mess on him, that he would pull Donald down with him. Now, I think that Dr. Kellogg's death was not an accident. I think that Donald killed him deliberately.
Melinda, Donald Lamar has the reputation of a man who is very, very honest. Now, it's going to be your word against his. You want to go to war against him?
Why are we looking at my old suite?
Because it's going to be your new office.
So, how do you think the state will feel about the head of your agency working in a luxury suite at the Holden Towers?
Well, I think it's going to be a psychological advantage for the parolees.
Yeah? How do you figure that?
Well, they come here to set up some dingy little hole in the wall. They look around, they realize we're serious about what we're doing. It motivates them. The word goes out. When they show up at their appointments, they get all fixed up. For instance, they'll wear nice clothes, so they won't look out of place.
Yeah, well, what if they feel out of place?
Well, that may happen, but it'll start them on the road to change.
Huh. Yeah, let me ask you to explain something. Why does this suite have a bedroom? See, I have absolutely no intention of using one.
Lee, I have no grand designs on getting you into bed. I rented this suite because I wanted you to be comfortable. That is my only reason.
Buddy, Mr. Buchanan has told me about his wife and his family.
Yeah, well, he talks about them like they're still part of his life, but the fact is they're not. I had a dog once. I was real good to him. One day I came into town, the dog wasn't there. I looked for that dog. I kept telling myself they were going to come back. They were going to come back, but, you know, we never did.
Sit down here. Buddy, are you trying to tell me that Mr. Buchanan's wife simply ran off?
Well, no, it's not like that. It's kind of hard to explain.
Well, were they kidnapped by desperados or Indians?
No. It's kind of like a tornado came and the wind just swept up his family. He's been looking for them in a mighty long time. Can't seem to find them. Good Lord, sure given him a good deal of problems. But, you know, he deals with them fine. That a weaker man just couldn't be able to handle. And you know, it ain't turned mean or anything.
It hasn't turned
mean. No, not a bit. And he's just so kind. He's got so much niceness in him.
Well, yes, of course, I have noticed that.
And my pa says that if you just get to know a person, that you'll see their good sides.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll get to like them.
No, it's them, buddy, not them. You must say the whole word.
Them.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, anyway, what I mean is that I think that if you just have patience, that you'll get to like Clint and you'll understand him.
Buddy, why would he not tell me about his family disappearing like that by himself?
Well, because he's a real cowboy, and real cowboys, he thinks, don't force their troubles on other people.
Perhaps I have judged him too harshly.
Well, I gotta go. I gotta go learn my lessons.
Don't you go to school?
Don't got a school. May learns me, and then buckboards to the other kids. Learns them, too.
No, May teaches you. You learn.
Yes, well, it seems that the less time May has to give me, the less time we get to teach. She's got to teach a lot of kids.
That's a deplorable situation.
Yes. Don't bother me none.
Buddy, do you know the meaning of the word deplorable?
No.
No. I would suggest when you get home, you look it up in your dictionary.
Dictionary? The only man around here who's got a dictionary is the parson.
Really?
Yeah.
You wait right here for me, you understand? I'm going to take these things upstairs to my room. I shall get my books and my hat, and I'm going to ride out to your farm with you. You wait right here. And is Max right? Do you still love Cord?
Vicky, how could you even ask me something like that? I mean, I never would have agreed to marry Max unless I loved him and unless I thought I could make him happy. I mean, sure, I made that little mistake, you know, by saying, I, Tina, take thee, Cord, to be my wedded husband, but it was just a mistake. I mean, I looked over there and Cord was standing right there and his name just slipped out. It was a mistake, pure and simple. I just can't get Max to understand that.
So, you do not love Cord. You have no feelings for him anymore.
Well, of course I love him. I mean, I was married to him. I had his son. I mean, you don't just stop loving somebody just because you're divorced or something. It's just that I love him differently than I love Max. I mean, what about you? Didn't you love Joe and Clint both? I mean, it's just that you love them in different ways.
Honey, that's an entirely different situation. Joe had died. Clint never felt he was in competition with Joe.
Well, Max isn't in competition with Cord. I mean, I love Cord as a friend, but Max and I were lovers, so what's the big deal all of a sudden?
Have you ever discussed this with Max?
Well, no, there's never any reason to. I mean, Max even moved in here right after you and Clint left to go to Arizona, and we lived together like we were married. And I loved him, and I trusted him, and I never gave him any reason not to trust me. And that's because I loved him, because I want to spend the rest of my life with him. And, you know, I'm not even going to have a life with him. If he's not in it, I might as well just roll up and die.
Hi.
Tina, I really don't want to hear any nonsense about wanting to die.
It's not nonsense. It's how I feel. I mean, I love Max just as much as you loved Clint. And I don't even want to face life without him.
Please sit up and stop crying. Hysterics don't help anyone.
You know, I don't get it. I finally have everything I want in life. I have my wonderful little baby. I work things out with Cord. We're friends. Max loves me. We're going to have kids of our own, and poof! I mean, why am I being punished like this?
You are not being punished. Max simply has doubts that only you can resolve for him. Honey, why aren't you in school?
Well, when I went to drop the boys off at school, Kevin refused to get out of the car.
Why, sweetheart? All your friends are there, all your favorite teachers.
I'm never going back to school, never.
I'll be back.
Tina, that was a rotten break. I'm real sorry.
So what can I do?
Well, I know being left at the altar is painful, not to mention embarrassing, but I think if I was in your place, what I would do is just be grateful that Max left you now instead of later.
Clint, how you doing?
Cody, how the hell you doing? We didn't expect you till tomorrow.
Well, I couldn't stay away a day longer. I wanted to find out how my bride was doing. How is she?
She's chomping at the bit. She was about to load up the buckboard and come and get you, bring you home. You got that land cleared?
Yeah, just about. You know, it was a tough winter up there, but I think we're going to be okay by the time crops come.
Cody!
Hey! Whoa, wait a second. Before you go to hugging and kissing me, I think I better take a bath and shave.
I have missed you so bad, I don't care about your whiskers.
Thought
you weren't coming home till tomorrow.
Yeah, well, I was wondering how my bride was doing. Wondering if she went to see the doctor and find out what he had to say.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Well, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, as in I'm going to be dead?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Oh, I don't believe it. Oh, this is great. You have made me the most happy man in the whole world twice now within a year. I don't believe it. I don't believe any of this. And I don't believe I'm swinging you around like a sack of potatoes, neither.
Would you quit treating me all delicate? The doctor says I'm absolutely fine. The only thing that could go wrong is a little morning sickness. We don't have anything to worry about.
So I'm going to be your daddy.
Yeah.
What do you think about that, Clint?
I think it's terrific. Terrific. Congratulations.
Listen, Buddy says that you're real good about predicting the future. Why don't you do a little prognosticating for us here now? Is this a little baby girl far as a little boy.
Well, you sure you want to know?
I do.
Yes, sir. I want to know, too.
It's a boy.
Boy! Well, what do you know about that? Well, you keep talking, sir, because I like what I'm hearing so far. You know, maybe I better go buy some more of that land right now, because it's right cheap. We need to find out if our son is going to marry himself a fine woman like his mother, or if he's going to be a sidebuster like his pa.
No, when he grows up to be a man, he's going to go to Mexico and seek his fortune there.
Mexico. What do you think about that, huh?
Well, whatever makes him happy, just as long as we don't lose touch with him, I guess.
Oh, no, you won't. No, Juan is going to be in touch with you for a long, long time.
Juan? Huh? After my granddaddy?
Do you want to name your son after him?
Well, I sure do. I've been thinking about that for a while. Are you just having fun with us here, Clint, or what?
Heck no, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do something like that.
Well, how do you know all these things, then?
We got company.
You think it's strange that Donald shows up in the ECT room right before Kellogg's about to kill me?
Not strange, a lucky coincidence, perhaps.
Except that Donald was responsible for my being there in the first place.
I'm sorry, I don't understand that.
Look, Rob and I suggested to Herb that I commit myself to Mountain View so I could go down there and dig up some evidence against Kellogg. Herb says, no way I'm going to let you do that. Then Donald steps in and says that it's a terrific idea.
The last time you were up in Mountain View, that was a setup? Uh-huh. Well, maybe Donald figured that's the only way to get evidence against Kellogg.
Or he figured it's a great way to kill off Kellogg. Now, look, he probably figured that Kellogg would catch on to me sooner or later. Maybe he even told Kellogg, thinking that he would kill me. So what happens? He walks in there, he saves me, kills Kellogg, he ends up looking like a big hero, and Kellogg's out of the way.
I don't know. Well, Linda, the news department at WBLE researched Donald in depth. Now, there's nothing in any of those reports. I mean, you saw them. You saw them the first time you interviewed Donald, right? There was nothing in those reports to indicate that Donald would get involved in anything like this.
Unless Donald is involved with the mob. That's why he was trying to tell Rob not to investigate his father's death. He was afraid he would come up with some incriminating evidence.
He asked Rob to step back from this?
Yes, he did. He said that his office was handling it and that Rob would just be in the way.
Perhaps he was just protecting Rob. Trying to keep him from getting hurt.
All right, forget it. Forget we even had this conversation. Obviously, you believe that Donald is a man of integrity and honesty, and I'm sorry I even brought you into it. I'll go call Herb, and Herb will investigate.
No, Melinda. Don't tell Herb about this. If you do, you might be signing your own death warrant.
Mattel Preschool.
Are you trying to tell me that Herb's involved in all this?
Donald Lamar's Herb Callison's boss. He's in and out of the DA's office all the time. They exchange information on different cases. It would be very difficult for Herb to keep the fact from Donald that you're making these accusations.
And if he doesn't?
Well, if you're right about what you say, would Donald want you alive?
No.
Okay. Then you can't let on what you know, can you?
Excuse me. Hello.
Hi, it's Donald Lamar. Hello, Melinda.
Yes, I'm here.
Is this a bad time to call? I wanted to ask you a little favor.
A favor?
Yes, Lee Sanders is opening the agency officially today, and I was wondering if you could invite her and some of the women on your show to give the agency a little boost.
Just a minute. It's Lamar. Get the phone in the bedroom. Donald, I'm really sorry. A messenger just came with something from the studio. I had to deal with it. An interview with Lee. I'll check into it. I know that we're very busy for the next couple of weeks, but I'll try to find a day.
Well, that's wonderful of you. Thanks. And it's great to hear the enthusiasm in your voice. You were a little under the weather the other day, and I was kind of worried for a minute you wouldn't be able to do the show.
Yeah, well, the flu has been going around the studio, and I think I might have just had a bit of it.
Okay, you take care of yourself. I want my favorite TV personality to be happy. You know, when you save somebody's life, you kind of tend to feel a little responsible for them. Okay, we'll talk later and perhaps have some lunch.
Yeah.
Okay, bye-bye.
So what's going on?
Well, Looks like Melinda wants you on her show. Well, she's going to check her calendar and she's going to give you a date.
Wow, that's great.
I think you're going to be terrific. Yeah? I think I'm going to stop by for a little moral support.
Well, I'm sure Tom will be there, too.
Tom, yes. Listen, if you're uptight about the bed, I think I'll call the hotel and they can change it into another room.
No, 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 Donald, that's fine, as long as we understand each other. This is my office. I only work here business hours, and everything is strictly professional here.
You're the boss. You make the rules. I'm going to follow them. Ah, I think that's your first interview.
Yeah, right on time.
Good luck.
Buddy told me that you teach the children here in Buchanan City, and I thought possibly you would like to have these.
Oh, my. This is like Christmas. Look at this, a dictionary.
Ooh.
Oh, and some readers. Are you sure you're not going to mind me using this thing?
I guessed.
It's a real nice gesture, Penny.
I have been dying for a dictionary. Look at that.
You know, honey, I kind of don't like the idea of you buckboarding back and forth from farm to farm now to teach these kids now that you're with child.
I realize that it is none of my concern, of course, but wouldn't it be a good deal easier for you and the children if you were all together in one place?
Well, yes, of course it would, but Jenny, we don't have a schoolhouse. And to get those farmers to get out and get their kids all out here at one time, that's just impossible.
See, ma'am, farmer life is real hard out here. That's why you need every hand you can get to help you with the crops.
I appreciate that, Mr. Vasquez. But your children are entitled to an education.
Yeah, I agree. Lee, what do you say we go do our lessons now?
You want to go in there and do your schoolwork, buddy?
Yeah, I want to learn that dictionary. I want to find out what some of these grown-up words mean.
Well, if you'll excuse us, I think we better get busy before this notion leaves him.
You go on ahead, of course.
Oh, Cody. You better unsaddle your bags on your horses and cool them down.
Good idea. I forgot all about that. You're right about that, bud. You know, I've been so worried about this little addition to our family, I didn't think about much else. I'll see you in a little bit.
Yep.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Tell me.
Okay.
May I get you a cup of coffee? A cup of tea?
No, thank you. I really am not going to stay. But before I leave, there is something I have to say to you, Mr. Buchanan.
As a hospital volunteer, I've noticed instead of Tylenol, patients here get Anacin 3.
A major hospital system replaced Tylenol tablets with Anacin 3, same aspirin-free medicine as Tylenol, but it costs them less.
Gloria Reeves, this is Donna Lamar.
Well, this won't be so bad after all. You my counselor?
No. Lee is.
Too bad. Well, nice meeting you anyway.
Yeah. I'll check with you later.
Yeah. So, why don't you sit down? Can I get you some coffee?
No. Coffee will only make me more jittery.
Well, I'll tell you, I'm a little nervous here, too. This is my first day, and you are my first client.
Lucky me.
So, why don't we look at your file here and see what's up? Okay, it says you worked at the power and light company, and then you took a job at a bar.
A dive on the waterfront.
Well, that's all right. That's all right with your secretarial experience. That's a plus. Listen, I don't know what kind of job with a future I can offer you, but I'm really going to try to get you one.
What kind of future are we talking here? I mean, fur coats and fancy apartments? Or just barely making ends meet?
Well, I think that depends on you. I can only give you a start.
Yeah, and once my boss finds out that I spent time in jail for hooking, I'm out in my butt.
No, no, that's not true. Look, the employees I deal with know exactly where you come from, and if they offer you a job, then the rest is up to you.
For minimum wage, right?
No, I think with your skills we can get you more than that, but let's just, I think you gotta drop this chip on your shoulder. Because with this attitude, no one's gonna give you a job, whether you're from jail or not.
Maybe I'm better off taking my chances on the streets.
Look, no, come on, do you really want your life to be about that? Do you want to have the danger of being arrested, or seriously injured, or contracting AIDS? Come on, do you really want to feel that useless?
Like someone is treating you like you're not even human? Work on your life. Do something about it. Don't sacrifice it.
Easy for you to say, lady. You've got it made. Don't start dumping that textbook stuff on me.
This is not any textbook stuff, Lori. I know what you're going through because I've lived it. I understand how you're feeling. I know it. It's from experience.
You?
Yeah, me. And it was really hard getting up, but I did. And it's because a friend took me and gave me the help I needed, and I made it. And I want you to make it too. I want to be your friend, and I want to help you, but you got to trust me. And you got to believe you can do it.
This is very difficult for me, Mr. Buchanan. I really never thought that I would ever have occasion to apologize to a man, and I certainly never thought that I would ever have to apologize to you. However, I find that I may have judged you too harshly, and for that I'm sorry.
Jenny, listen, I...
No, please. Please do not interrupt me. Otherwise, I shall turn and run. It is embarrassing enough for me to be saying this, and I also find that I'm furious with myself for believing in my mother's conviction that men are not to be trusted.
Well, there's a lot of men out there that shouldn't be trusted. I don't count myself among them, but...
Well, neither do I. Not anymore. But for goodness sakes, you really must share in a part of the blame. If you had only told me about your wife and your family disappearing, I would certainly have been more understanding.
Well, it's kind of hard to explain, Jenny, and...
Well, yes, I realize that. Buddy explained to me how cowboys don't like to share their feelings with other people. But really, after I had spoken to you about my past and my feelings, you certainly could have spoken too.
I never meant to be dishonest with you. I hope you believe that.
Buddy characterized your family's disappearance by saying it was as if a gust of wind had swept them away.
Or maybe it was me that the gust of wind swept away. The point is, I can't find them, they can't find me, and I don't know if I'll ever see them again.
How very sad.
Well, like they say, the Lord works in mysterious ways. I'll just have to trust that he knows what he's doing and do my best to play the hand that he deals me.
My goodness. You are not only hopelessly romantic, you're also a very optimistic fellow.
Well, it beats going around looking at my boots and missing the good things that are going on around me. Jenny, I appreciate... You're apologizing to me and your understanding. Thank you.
Well, Max is obviously confused right now. I mean, once he starts thinking clearly, he'll realize how much he loves me and that he can't live without me any more than I can live without him.
Tina, if he walked out of the church on you and then he walked out on you there at the hotel suite after you went to see him, I think he figures he can live without you. I'm sorry it has to be that way, and I know it hurts like hell, but it just might be time that you start accepting that.
You're no help at all.
Well, I'm trying, but... Excuse me, I want to check on Vicky and Kevin.
The gypsy legend says you look in the stone and you can't tell a lie. Oh, I do love you, Max. I really do.
Presenting Fisher-Price Sports. Take a look at these kids play. This baseball game has everything. It's got bases. There's Rocky stealing third. It's got action. There goes another one over the...
So you believe me now?
Well, I believe it's worth looking into. I think I'll do a little more research into Donald Lamar's background. And in the meantime, till I come up with some clues, Just don't let him know you suspect anything, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Oh, sorry, I forgot there for a moment. This letter came to WVLE for you.
Oh, it's from Whitney. She's a patient at Mountain... Wait a minute, Tom. Whitney is the one who showed me Alex Crown's grave. She's the one who said that there were three men digging that grave. Three. Dr. Kellogg, the man who strangled him.
And you think the third one might have been Donald Lamar?
Exactly. And if Whitney can look at Lamar and identify him, maybe we'll have just the evidence we need to get him.
Okay, remember, stay away from Lamar and Mountain View until I've had a chance to do my research, okay? One step at a time, all right?
Okay, but if anything comes up, I want you to let me know.
You bet.
Whitney is being released from Mountain View. How perfect.
I don't have an appointment, but I just wanted to hear how the first interview went.
Well, it went fine.
Did she open up to you? Trust you?
Yes, she did, and I got her a job.
Oh, it's fantastic.
Oh, look, it was so astonishing. You know, I got really caught up in helping this woman and trying to find her a job, and I thought of this client at Dyna Women. So I called him up, and he gave her one. Now, who could that be? I don't have an appointment, no?
Lunch for Miss Sanders?
Oh, no, sorry, that's a mistake. I didn't order any lunch.
I did.
What?
I had a feeling things would go well.
Look, Donald, I don't know about this.
Some bosses hand out certificates of merit. I treat my agency heads to lunch. And I certainly hope that's not against the rules.
You know, it seems like all I've done since I met you is apologize to you for interfering in your life.
You do have a terrible habit of meddling in things that don't concern you.
But you do concern me, Jenny. Your happiness concerns me. All right. I probably am wrong for pushing Randolph Lord on you as hard as I did, but I just have this strong feeling, this conviction that the cornerstone to life itself is a relationship between a man and a woman. And I firmly believe that you are a woman who deserves to experience all that, all the best of life. And the best that it has to offer is love and marriage and kids and grandkids and... I'm doing it again. I overstepped my boundaries. I'm sorry.
Apology accepted, Mr. Buchanan.
Clint.
I certainly appreciate your kindness and your concern. But I really do feel that the good Lord has different plans for me.
Well, not necessarily. Randolph Lord is going to be back in town in 2 months. Never can tell what might develop.
In 2 months, I will be in St. Louis. Mr. Lord will be a memory. A pleasant one, but a memory nonetheless. I really must be getting back to town.
Well, why don't I tie my horse to the back of your buggy and just kind of ride along with you?
Thank you very much, but I think you should... go back to your work. I'm sure I will find my way back to town.
Will you have lunch with me? Today? At the hotel? I mean, the food's good, and I'd really appreciate and be much obliged to you for sharing your company with me and your knowledge. I mean, about San Francisco, St. Louis, you know, cowboys don't get around that much. We don't know that much about city life. And I'm very curious. I promise I'll mind my manners, and I won't embarrass you. I promise. Come on, what do you say?
1 o'clock?
I'll be there. Hallelujah.
Don't you just hate it? You're all set to wear your brand new swimsuit.
Clint, I saw Miss Jenny leave.
You little rascal. I didn't even know you went to town this morning.
Well, I just figured someone had to try to make her understand that we didn't mean her any harm.
Yeah? Well, just how did you go about getting her to understand it?
I told her the truth.
What?
Well, as close as the truth as I could tell her without ruining everything, she was just worried that you were trifling with her affections.
Trifling with her affections? She said that?
Yeah, she said trifling with something. May said she probably meant affections. We looked up the word affections in the dictionary.
Hey, now you okay?
Yeah. Well, I just wanted you to know that it was Miss Jenny's idea to come out to the farm, not mine.
Yeah, prodded by you, no doubt, which I greatly appreciate, partner.
Well, how'd you guys get along? Did you get along okay?
We got along better than ever. She apologized to me, I apologized to her. Matter of fact, we're gonna have lunch together.
Wow, that's great!
Yeah, but I gotta try and figure out some way to keep her here in town until Randolph Lord returns.
But that's 2 months away.
I know.
Miss Jeannie said that she's gonna be on the buggy ride out here. She told me that she's gonna be leaving on the stage at the end of this week.
I know, and I can't let her go.
So what do we do? We gonna play another trick on her?
No, we're through playing tricks. Every time we do that, it backfires on us and hurts her. There's gonna be no more playing tricks on her.
So what do we...
I think you ought to go to bed. I will think of something.
Yeah, well, this is a mighty big problem we got on our hands.
Yeah, but nobody said it was gonna be easy. Whatever it takes, that's what we'll have to do.
Clint, you're not just doing this because you want to get back to your family, are you? You really want to make Miss Jenny happy.
Yeah. Yes, I do. I want to make sure that all our futures are happy ones. Run along.
It's just... so incredible that I am so caught up in all of this. I'm sitting here and I just can't wait for my next interview.
You mean I should finish my lunch and get out?
No, wait, stay. I mean, unless you mind sitting here listening to me talk about my first success.
No, I love it. I love it. I love being with you and your enthusiasm and your joy. I've missed it. I remember the first time that you came and worked on my campaign. You lit up my headquarters like a 4th of July rocket. God, you were so contagious. I mean, there are people who have been sitting on their hands for 2 weeks doing nothing, and they leapt to the phones, and they were asking for contributions and votes, and it was like magic.
Oh, you know, it's funny. When I turn on the TV, or, you know, I watch the primaries, I think about that time. We were so young and idealistic, and we believed that anything we did could happen.
But you held on to that idealism, despite everything.
No, I lost it for a while, but I think it's coming back. I guess everything comes around full circle in your life, huh?
That's what they say. I certainly hope they're right. Don't fight it. New directions.
Yes, Donald Lamar's secretary said that I might find him here.
Yes, this is Donald Lamar.
Oh, hi. It's Melinda Kramer.
Hi. Have you found a date for Lee to appear on your show yet?
Well, no, I'm still working on it. But if you trade favors with me, you know, I just might be able to get her a date next week.
Okay, and what's the deal?
Would you please ask Lee to interview someone for me and give her some advice and help her find a job?
Well, sure, but if she's a parolee, all she has to do is call and ask for an appointment.
Well, you see, Whitney actually hasn't been in prison. She's just being released from Mountain View Clinic, and she's very uptight about being out on her own. I know it's a state agency, Donald, but...
There's no problem. You get our story across, and Lee will see what she can do for your little friend.
Oh, thank you, Donald, thank you. Whitney Howard is her name. Should I have her call up Lee and set up an appointment?
Sure.
Oh, one more thing, by the way. Look, do you think that maybe you could just spare a little time to say hello to her? It would just mean so much to her to know that someone in power is interested in her, you know?
Yeah, well, I come by from time to time, so I will coordinate my schedule with Lee's.
Oh, thanks, Donald, and I'll have her call Lee real soon.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Well, Mr. Donald Lamar, if Whitney recognizes you as the man who helped Kellogg dig Alex Crown's grave, you'll soon be on your way to prison.
Give up on you, Max. I'm never gonna give up on you. I just gotta think of some way to make you see that we belong together. I just had the sexiest idea.
Shopping can make you feel terrific when you find fabulous color, fit, and style. But when you also find the Made in the USA label, you feel even better. It's a great feeling.
Made in the USA.
Have some Butterball.
I'm worried about you, Mom. These are cold cuts. Butterball's a turkey.
Not always. Now Butterball is turkey cold cuts. Great tasting bologna, pastrami, and salami.
Yeah, just put those papers in my office. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thanks. I'll see you later. What are you doing here?
Well, I figure I'm about the last person you want to see right about now.
You figured right. Close the door behind you.
Max, there's something I want to say to you, and I hope that you're going to sit and listen to me.
Court, I'm very busy trying to run a hotel here.
What you're doing is you're throwing yourself into your work instead of dealing with the matters at hand.
Mm-hmm.
Max, if you just deal with the truth, the sooner you do that, the sooner you'll feel a whole lot better. And the truth is, you love Tina, and she loves you, and I see the two of you having a happy life together yet.
Tina and I are finished. End of discussion.
Well, I got news for you. Tina doesn't want it to be over. And I think if you're honest with yourself, you'll realize that you don't want it to be over either. Max, don't do this. You are making the biggest mistake of your life.
You know what, Tina? Maybe we ought to ask Karen to bring in a couple extra chairs for this reading.
Well, Vicky said we wouldn't need them.
What do you say, Vicky? Are the kids going to be here?
No. No, just you, Court Nasa.
And you?
No. I came down to ask Tina if she would represent me.
What? But, Vicky, I'm sure most of it's going to be about you. I'm sure he left practically everything to you.
Probably. I just don't really think I'm ready to hear his last wishes, his very last words to us. I know I asked that the reading of the will be postponed until I felt I was strong enough, but I'm just not. I'm sorry, I'm not.
That's okay. I mean, if you want me to, sure, I'll be there for you.
Thanks,
Well, you know, Vicky, Tina here, she's not much better shape than you are right now.
Well, I'll pull myself together for my sister. I mean, it's the least I can do for her.
Well, you know what I was figuring is that maybe if I'm there beside you just to give you moral support, it might make it easier for you to see this thing through.
That you'd just changed your mind.
Are you fooling? Wild horses couldn't keep me from having lunch with Chip. Now, is everything ready?
Yeah, the cooks are fixing up her favorite dishes.
Not the food, everything else. Is Buck going to live up to his end of the bargain?
Oh, well, he better, unless he wants the shortest marriage on record.
What, you threatened him with divorce?
Well, and a few other things. He's not likely to want to live with that. Oh, hi, Jenny.
Lays, how very nice to see
you. Good to see you.
Hello, Clint.
How do, Miss Fletcher? You know, I'm sure obliged to you for agreeing to have lunch with me, but I think we picked the worst possible day to do it.
Here's what to do when you don't find the rainbows in this time. Here's where you go when it looks like the rain won't end. Don't cry.
A mascara rich with conditioners is smart. A mascara that makes lashes the thickest is beautiful.
Maybelline Great Lash Mascara.
What big eyes you have.
Great Lash conditions.
Pump it up.
As it thickens.
Unleash those lashes.
For the biggest, thickest lashes ever.
Wow.
Great Lash Mascara.
Lay it on thick.
Smart. Beautiful. Maybelline.
Baby, you've never looked better.
Can I take your picture today?
Don't know when I've seen such a smile. Don't you love all we do to get the best out of you?
Through Saturday only, get 2 8x10s, 3 5x7s, 15 wallet size, and 3 portrait charms for just $19.95.
A face like yours deserves all they're the best. I gotta tell you, baby, you've never looked better.
Terrific.
Just look for your life and sears.
Hurry, time is running out on Color Tile's biggest sale of the year. Your last chance to save up to 50%. Ceramic tiles, vinyl tiles, mosaics, even wall coverings. This stylish ceramic tile, just 59 cents. Venetian wall tile, 63 cents. Rich wood parquet floors, $1.40 to $1.56. And sundial solarian, only $8.99 after rebate. Color Tile's biggest sale of the year. Come now and bring the beauty home. Hurry, sale ends Sunday, March 27th.
7 a.m. and Judy and Jeannie start cooking sausage. 7:05.
Brown and Serve's ready.
Jeannie's family uses Swift Premium Brown and Serve. Just 5 minutes from sizzle to serve.
Hey, Mom!
Why wait? Get Swift Premium Brown and Serve. Great taste without the wait.
Have you ever seen homemade taste?
Hmm?
With Prego, you see the basil.
Mm.
With Ragu.
I can't see it.
With Prego, you see the oregano.
Oh.
With Ragu.
I can't see it.
So why buy Ragu?
I can't see it.
Prego, homemade taste. You can see it.
I must say, this is quite an office for a government agency, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. No gray filing cabinets, no fluorescent lights, no techie
company. How do you rate this?
Well, Donald Lamar arranged it.
Oh, yeah. I found out yesterday when he was on WBLE that this whole agency is his brainchild.
Yeah. I was sort of hesitant at first about taking this job, Tom, but I thought about it, and I got really excited at the idea of helping these parolees change their life, find a new course. You know, everything we were talking about. Would you have felt so positive about it if you knew that I was reporting to Donald?
Oh, I hardly know the man.
Well, he's a good man, Tom. And I think he's really concerned about the success of these people. And, well, that's what the program is about anyway. There's one other thing I think you should know.
Mm-hmm.
I am not going to let this job interfere with our life. It is not going to take over. It is going to be a job from 9 to 5. And at 5 o'clock, I go home. I don't take my work with me. I don't take business calls. Weekends and weeknights are devoted to the family. I really feel that we've We've come a long way, and I don't want to ruin that. So I will be here for you if you ever need me.
And I'm never going to let you forget that.
Okay. Well, I don't want you to. Now, I have to kick you out. I have to get ready for an interview.
Okay, I can take a hint. I don't need to have a house fall on me. Okay. I'll see you at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, 5:30. Okay. No later.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
I do hope there is not going to be a shootout of some kind.
No. This is a peaceful town now. But the thing is, I don't think the hotel is going to be all that quiet this afternoon because of the school.
What school?
Well, the local kids are coming by here to take their lessons.
Here?
Yes, and actually, it's pretty much your fault. You know, when you gave May that dictionary and those readers, well, she got all fired up and decided to enlist the aid of the townspeople in educating the kids. Now, since we don't have our schoolhouse or a permanent teacher, we just have to make do with what we got.
But in a hotel lobby?
Beats a saloon.
Oh, yes. Well, I certainly cannot argue with that.
Yeah. Well, May's hoping that if this thing works out, the folks will get together and build a schoolhouse.
Yes, but what about a teacher?
Well, folks here in town are taking turns at it. I know you're not real comfortable at the saloon, Jenny, but I think probably be more quiet if we went over there and had
a tea. No, really. A few children learning their 3 R's certainly wouldn't bother me in the slightest.
Really?
Oh.
Well, let's go into the dining room then. It's a lovely dress.
Thank you very much. I would like to have the special for the day, please. It's usually quite good.
Oh, well, I'll have the same. I'll drink lemonade or coffee and tea for the lady.
Mr. Buchanan, Clint, I was on my way home from the farm to the town this morning, and I started thinking about your problem. One of the unfortunate aspects of the settling of the West has been its effect on families. Many have been torn apart, loved ones separated for various reasons beyond their control.
Well, that's the price you pay for forging new frontiers.
Have you considered possibly writing to some of the large newspapers around the country? You know, many of them have a column where you can list missing persons. Have you thought about such a thing? Perhaps you'll be able to find your wife and children.
Well, appreciate your suggesting it.
Well, here, you see, I have written down the names and the addresses of some of these large newspapers that do have such a column, and I think it is worth a try, don't you?
Well, I don't think it'd really do me all that much good, Jenny. I mean, my situation is kind of unusual.
But surely, you're not going to abandon the search for them and give up hope.
I guarantee you, my heart is so full of hope that it absolutely aches from the sheer weight of it.
You would think that you would take more pride in the education and welfare of its citizens.
No time to teach a bunch of screaming kids.
Oh, my dear. Buck Buchanan is the teacher today?
Oh, don't make her feel so guilty. I mean, if Vicky doesn't want to hear the will being read, well, then that's fine. That's her business.
Darling, it's okay. He's just being his typical generous beau. Tell you what you can help me with. Would you help me explain the will to the children? I'd like them to understand as much as possible why it's there, what it's for.
Sure. Sure. You want to do that right now?
Yes, they're home from school now, so let's...
Okay. See you.
Thank you.
Well, who's here? She's in the library.
Max! Oh, hi. I'm sorry, Tina. Were you expecting Matt to change his mind?
I was hoping he would, but I guess I'm hoping for a miracle.
Oh. Max, she slipped up. She made a mistake.
No, the mistake was mine, thinking she could ever love me.
She did love you. She does love you, Max. What? Come on, she has committed herself to you a long time ago. She renewed that commitment to you when she invited you to live with her over at Landfair, and she did the same thing when she walked down the aisle yesterday.
She thinks she loves me. She's convinced herself of it, and I was able to convince myself that she could change, that she could just get over loving you. Well, it's time to face the truth, and I can't ignore it anymore, and you may as well face it too, buddy.
You know, I never denied that I cared about her or that she cared about me because we have that child, little Clint, in common. We will always have him. Max, We got a share in bringing him up, and you are going to help us with that. We're not rivals. What we are is a couple of men who happen to love the same woman at different times. My love was in the past. Your love is in the present and for the rest of your life.
Why didn't you marry Kate?
What?
The answer is Tina.
The answer is, Kate and I decided that we just didn't love each other enough.
Kate loved you, but you were still hooked on Tina. You delayed your wedding twice because of Tina.
The woman came back from the dead, Max, and she had a child in her arms, a child that she was claiming was my son at the time. Now, what else could I do? We were still legally married.
Just want you to admit your feelings.
My feelings are that you are blowing a good thing here, Max, because of your stupid pride and your jealousy.
If I were worried about my pride, I wouldn't have taken Tina down to Buenos Aires. And I wouldn't have wasted a whole year of my life believing that I could be the guy to make her happy.
You know, Bo said that she has not stopped crying once since you walked out on her at the church. Now, how exactly do you account for that?
Oh, she hasn't faced her real feelings. And when she does, and when you do, I'm going to offer you both my best wishes.
Talking to you is like talking to a robot that's already been pre-programmed.
You want proof of Tina's feelings? You listen very carefully at the reading of Clint's will today.
What the hell does a will have to do with Tina?
Pay attention. You'll have proof that Tina is not ready to give you up. She doesn't even want to share you. Mm-hmm. And I can't live with that. Close the door on your way out. I got work to do.
So my whole life is just falling down around me, and all because of some stupid mistake, but I don't know what to do or say to Max to make it up to him.
Well, I don't know what you did.
During the vows, I said Cord's name instead of Max's.
Oh, Tina, no wonder Max walked out on you.
Well, it was just a stupid mistake. I didn't do it on purpose or anything. Look, I said how sorry I was.
How would you feel if Max said someone else's name instead of yours?
Well, I'd be hurt and I'd be angry.
And you'd also feel like you were there by default because his first choice had turned him down.
Max is my first choice.
Oh, Tina, when Max fell in love with you, you made it perfectly clear that you were still in love with Cord. You were so desperate to get back together with him that you lied to me about being married to Max, and you lied to Cord about the baby.
I don't know why you're bringing up all that right now.
Because, you know, I think it's very important that you realize that Max had reason to doubt, and when you made that slip, you just confirmed his doubts.
All right, I didn't love him back then, but I loved him later. And he always knew that he was the right man for me, just like he knew that I'd want to love him the rest of my life. That's why I wanted to marry him, so why would he have all these doubts all of a sudden?
Have you spoken to him since the wedding?
I tried to. I went over there to talk to him, and he didn't even want to talk to me. I can't tell you how that hurt me.
Oh, Tina. Believe me, I'm so sorry for you and for Max.
So then you helped me think of a way to get him back?
Tina, I'm the wrong person to ask that.
I know you're my best friend, and I know you want me to be happy, and I'll never be happy without Max, so you've got to help me, please.
Now, you know I got any use for kids. That's a worry I could do without.
Hell, I'd rather meet a guy at high noon than spending 3 hours teaching a bunch of brats.
And what about the children that we're planning to have? Or would you rather
your Buchanan name just to stop with your demise?
Well, we're gonna have one.
One? Honey.
All right, maybe two, but not a whole room full.
After dealing with a whole room full, maybe you'll appreciate our two even more.
You take over the teaching chores today. I'll do it some other time.
I can't. The whiskey wagon's coming in. I gotta meet him at the saloon.
Shoot, I can do that for you.
No, you're staying here. Now help me bring that blackboard in.
Honey, half these kids don't have sense to command the rain. Now, how am I going to improve minds that cannot be improved?
Oh, come on.
No, he's just blown off steam. He's going to do just fine with the kids.
Children are impressionable. For heaven's sakes, it's terrible to expose them to a curmudgeon like that. I apologize. I realize I'm a visitor to this town, and I have absolutely no right to interfere.
No, you have right to express an opinion. But the thing is, folks around here have to make do with what's available, Jenny. And the fact is, Buck is one of the best available.
Oh, you cannot be serious.
Well, he knows how to read. And he must know something about numbers just from counting all these cattle.
Are you going to try your hand at teaching as well?
I guess I'll offer to do my part. Well, wait a minute. You were going to tell me all about city living, remember?
Yes, of course. What did you want to know?
Tell me about the opera house.
Oh, the opera house is extraordinary. It seats hundreds of people, most of whom wear their satins and their silks and their jewels, and the men come in white tie and tails.
Come on, school's going to start hurting soon.
All very, very plush red velvet. Oh, my, aren't they darling? Oh, who could fail to find happiness and joy when they're in the presence of children?